about called what? Desire to grow. Amen? Tell your neighbor, desire to grow. If you are a visitor, you've not been here before, I welcome you. By the way, I see you, my sister, back there. Have you been to JCC before? Yeah. Oh, we have a free gift for you as we welcome you. Come on, ushers. Let's appreciate her. Amen, 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 amen. We love visitors and we welcome you, and we welcome you permanently. I thought I would get more support from that. Amen. Amen. Here you are a visitor once and then you stay. We have room. Amen. So we are going to continue looking at the word that we started and I'm finishing today, hopefully, called desire to grow. Desire to grow. How many people are growing? How many people have been meditating on this word about growing? God desire for you to grow. God desire for you to grow. Amen? I say God desire for you to grow. 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 I say God desire for you to grow. Somebody say amen. God does not desire for you to remain the same place. He desire of you to grow. I want us to turn the Bible, our Bibles, to the book of Ephesians chapter 13. Ephesians chapter 13. And then we'll read Galatians chapter 1. Ephesians chapter 13, chapter 3, verse 13. And then we'll read Galatians chapter 4, verse 1. That's where we ended last Sunday. The Bible says, therefore, I ask that you do not lose heart at my tribulations for you, which is your glory. For this reason, I bow my knees to the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, from whom the whole family in heaven and earth is named, that he would grant you, according to the riches of his glory, to be strengthened with might through his Spirit in the inner man, that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith, that you, being rooted and grounded in love, may be able to comprehend with all the saints what is the width, the length, the depth, and the height, and height, to know the love of Christ which passes knowledge, that you may be filled with the fullness of God. Now, verse 20, to him who is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that we ask or think, according to the power that works in us, to him be glory in church by Christ Jesus to all generations forever and ever. Amen. May the Lord bless that reading of the word. Then we go to Galatians chapter 1, chapter 4, verse 1. Galatians chapter 4, verse 1. If you're there, say amen. The Bible says, now I say that the heir, as long as he is a child, does not differ from a slave, though he is master of all. Can we read that again? Now, I say that the heir, as long as he is a child, does not differ at all, that's an emphasis, from a slave, though He is a master of all. Somebody say amen. Amen. We kind of ended here last Sunday, and I won't go back too deeply because of time. I encourage us to go online. We always post our messages. If you have missed any part of this message, I want to believe they are uploaded. Please go watch so that you can catch up. But last Sunday, I ended by saying that it is your portion to grow. Turn to your neighbor, tell them, it is your portion to grow. God wants you to grow. Already, you are in Christ Jesus. Amen? When you are in Christ Jesus, what happens to you? You become included in the family of God. So the Bible says in the book of Romans chapter 8 that you are a heir of God and a heir together with Jesus Christ. The Bible says that the Spirit of God bears witness in our spirit that we are children of God, that we are heirs. And I was asking you, what does it mean to be a heir? It's to have to be somebody who has an inheritance. Come on, talk to me. Somebody say amen. Amen. If you are a heir of your father, it means that you are entitled to what your father possesses. And I was saying how people even kill each other over inheritance. Amen? If you come from a place, like a place I come from, you find brothers and sisters who have grown up together, killing each other because of an inheritance. Why? An inheritance if it's your livelihood. That is why we find the prodigal son who was a heir of the father. In his immaturity, he came and asked the father, give me a piece, a portion of my inheritance. What did the father do? The father gave it to him because he was entitled to that inheritance. But there was a problem. He was an immature heir. Because when you are an immature heir, an inheritance will destroy you. And sure enough, this young man took the inheritance, and the Bible says he went away to a faraway land, and there he squandered the inheritance. And before he realized, he was so depleted that he started sitting with the pigs and eating swine's food. And the Bible says one day, he came back to his senses. And he asked himself a question, that even the servants in my father's house are eating better than I am eating. I am therefore going to go back and beg my way in. Somebody say amen. I'm talking to this to say that when we are in Christ Jesus, we are not in Christ Jesus just by saying. We are heirs. We have an inheritance in God. Turn to your neighbor. Tell them you have an inheritance in God. In order for you to enjoy the inheritance. That is why in Ephesians chapter 3, the passage that we read, Paul is talking to the brethren. He's telling them, I don't want you to be troubled by my tribulation. I don't want you to be troubled by my suffering. But I pray that you be strengthened in your inner man so that you can be able to comprehend the depth, the width, and the height of Christ's love to you, which passes knowledge. What he's telling them, that now that you are in Christ Jesus, and remember these are Gentiles, and Gentiles were not entitled. Woo! Somebody say amen. The Gentiles were not entitled to an inheritance. The ministry of Paul was the one. And actually, if you read the beginning of this passage, Paul will begin to say that God called him and he taught him through liberation so that he can bring the mysteries of Christ to the Gentiles so that they can inherit. Somebody say amen. So he said, I pray that you be strengthened in your inner man so that you be able to comprehend. I pray in the name of Jesus that you be strengthened in your inner man this morning so that you can be able to comprehend the portion of your inheritance in Jesus' name. Amen. Somebody say amen. So when you go to the passage that we just read, the Bible says, Galatians chapter 4 verse 1, and in this season I would like that word, by the mercies of God, to be engraved in your spirit. Paul is telling the brethren in Galatians that if a heir, and we have established that a heir is somebody who is entitled with an inheritance. If a heir is a child, in other words, if a heir is a child, in other words, they don't grow, they are, there is no difference, and the Bible says at all. Who are slaves? Slaves don't have an inheritance. Slaves just work. They work for peanuts, but they don't have an inheritance. But heirs, even in the father's house, they possess what their fathers possess. Paul is saying, if a heir is a child, they do not differ from a slave. Let me elaborate that for the sake of those that are joining us today. That if you are a heir in Christ, but you do not grow in faith, you remain like a slave. Somebody say amen. I say if you are a heir in Christ, but you do not grow in Christ, you remain like a slave. Let me come close to you. I say if you are a heir, God has given you every blessing. You are a heir of his healing. That means by the stripes of Jesus you are healed. That is your inheritance in Christ. Amen. You are a heir that silver and gold belongs to you. You are a heir that you should be anxious for nothing. That is your portion. That you will call on heaven and God will hear you. All these are entitled to you through this body, through the new covenant. Somebody say amen. That means when you are sick, according to your capacity as a heir of God, you begin to say, I am healed in Jesus' name. I am healed in Jesus' name. By the stripes of Jesus, I am healed. I say, by the stripes of Jesus, I am healed. When you are a heir, you can say, I believe the report of the Lord. They say, I will never wake up, but according to my inheritance, I shall be healed. Because God sent his word to save and to heal me. And somebody say, amen. Amen. But if you remain a spiritual baby, the Bible says that you remain like a slave. A slave has no rights. Is somebody with me? Yes. Slaves just do what the master wants them to do. If you're told to go this direction, in fact, slaves are even given kind of clothes they wear. Amen. And you know who would be our master when we fail to walk authentically with God? The devil. He will take something small and torment you with it. But because you are an immature in faith, you say, you know that is how things are. You begin to buy into the lie of the devil. He torments you with depression. You begin to say that is your portion. You begin to talk, oh, this, you know, nowadays mental health, everybody is depressed. That tells you that you are a child in the things of God because you don't understand your portion. Oh, somebody say amen. Oh, something small happened, you believe in that thing. But when you know Amen. This is your inheritance. As long as you remain a child of faith, you will not be able to stand on your right as a heir. But Jesus has come. Amen. God wants you to grow. Talk to your neighbor. Tell them, God wants you to grow. Desire to grow. Come on, talk to somebody. Tell them, desire to grow. So that you can enjoy your full inheritance. Come on, testify to a couple people. Tell them, desire to grow. Desire to grow. Desire to grow. Paul is saying that we've been looking at that word. That Peter is saying, not Paul. That desire, pure milk. Amen. Desire, the word, as a nursing baby, desires milk so that you may grow. And you'll be able to distinguish what is right and what is wrong. Somebody say amen. Amen. Can we turn there as I continue quickly? 1 Peter chapter 2. This was our beginning passage. This was a beginning passage. And that is where we are going to end. 1 Peter chapter 2 verse 1. The Bible says, therefore, laying aside all malice, all deceit, hypocrisy, envy, and evil speaking, as newborn babes, desire the pure milk of the word, that you may grow thereby. If indeed you have tasted that the Lord is gracious, coming to him as to a living stone, rejected by men, but chosen by God and precious. You also are living as living stones are being built up. Amen. A spiritual house, a holy priesthood, to offer up spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God through Jesus Christ. We have been looking at that scripture, and I read it again to emphasize. Paul is saying, lay aside. And we have seen one thing that hinders growth is sin. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
Talk to your neighbor, tell them sin will hinder your growth.
Sin.
Open sin, sacred sin will hinder your growth. So Peter is saying, lay aside all these things and desire the milk, the word. As newborn babes desire milk. Somebody say amen. My emphasis this morning is that God wants you to grow. Everything, God wants you to grow in the things of faith so that you can read the word more. You can share the gospel more. In the book of Hebrews, we are being told, or the author of the Hebrews says, that by now you should be teachers of the word. Amen. When you grow, you teach others. I was meditating on the Great Commission that we find in Matthew 28. Can we go there quickly? Matthew 28. Matthew 28. Verse 18, the Bible says, Jesus came and spoke to them, saying, all authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth. Go therefore, make disciples of all nations, doing what? Baptizing them in the name of the Father, of the Son, of the Holy Spirit. I want you to notice verse 20. Teaching them, yeah? To observe all things that I have commanded you, and lo, I am with you always to the end of the age. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
I was saying last Sunday, and I would like to emphasize that your growth in the Lord is not just for you. There are people who are waiting for you to grow up.
Amen.
There are some breakthroughs that are waiting for you to grow up.
Amen.
Some of the people you're saying, I wish my brother can stop drinking. They are waiting for you to be serious. Oh, I want my father to be born again. First of all, become serious in the things of God. Oh, I want my marriage to be healed. I want my my life to be restored. Grow. Amen. Some of the breakthroughs you're waiting for are waiting for you to grow. Because as you begin to testify, as you begin to walk with the Lord, you become a testimony in that family. You become a testimony to those children. As long as you are lukewarm, as long as we are spiritual babies, because you cannot actually stand on your ground and say, you will not torment these children anymore. Why? You have no idea. So the devil keep on tormenting your children because you are not in your position. The devil continue to torment your marriage. Why? Because you are a spiritual baby. The moment you become serious with God, and that's why I believe spiritual growth should be the number one priority of every believer. Only then we begin to live as heirs. If your neighbor is asleep, tell him, wake up, pastor is saying something. Not unless you listen when your eyes are closed. Somebody say amen. Amen. Do you know when you fully submit yourself to God, your growth is supernatural. The moment you say, God, I take your word, I leave social media for a moment, and I dig my head in the word, I stand in your word, I proclaim, I stand on every promise, growth begin to happen in a way that you will not understand. Or somebody say, amen. Amen. Can I ask you, how many people think of how they will grow? Amen. Like now, when kids are growing, do they sit and think how they will grow? Yeah, all they do is eat. Or somebody say amen. Amen. How did you plan to be six feet tall, my brother? How did you figure that out? How did you figure out that you are the size that you are, that you are the shape that you are? You did it. That is the work of God. All you do is take care of that body. Eat right. Amen. Take care of yourself. Make good judgments. The growth will happen. You know, I say this. There is nothing intriguing as a baby growing in your body. Yeah? How many people have been pregnant here before? Yeah, I'm just kidding. And if you're not pregnant, one day you will either be a father, so you will witness. I thank those that are saying amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. Hallelujah. One day you will be, so stay with me. Whether you are to be a father or a mother. The word is relevant. Amen. One tip I can tell you, something that is really intriguing is when you have conceived. At some point you don't know you have conceived. Somebody say amen. But growth begins to happen immediately a conception happens. You are just minding your own business. You are running if you are a runner. But it begins to grow day after day. After 3 weeks, you feel like, oh, my tummy hurt. My head hurt. I feel like puking. I feel like I want to eat stones. Sausages that you left in farmer's choice before you realize there's something wrong with me. This is not how I usually I am. That is why that should happen in a context of marriage. Somebody say amen. 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 You quickly learn. It's because there is a baby growing in you, and the growth begins. Amen. Now that you know, you begin to enjoy, and then you are intentional about it. But it's amazing because every day counts. The clothes you wore on Sunday will not fit you this Sunday. Somebody say amen. Amen. Say hallelujah, Sister Emily. Oh, hallelujah. Amen. And the growth begins. You know, when we were expecting Nathaniel every Sunday evening, we sat. watched what is happening. And this Sunday they will tell us, now who is now Nathaniel? He's the size of a pear. The other day he's the size of a mango. Towards the end it's the size of a watermelon. Somebody say amen. One cannot get over. Amazing. You are not in control of it. The one who has ordained life, amen, is in control of that which he has deposited in you. And it's the same thing that I want to bring forth to you. As long as you allow God to work in your life, as long as you begin to submit yourself to the word, growth will happen. Or oh, somebody say amen. Because it is the desire of God that you grow. And you cannot grow in the things of the spirit and not grow in the other areas of your life. When you grow spiritually, you grow financially. I was sharing last Sunday, promotion comes from above. Things become, you begin to grow always because it is according to the covenant of God. Can somebody say amen? God desire for you to grow. God does not want you to remain the same place, talking about the same stories, fighting the same battles. No, he wants to move you to the next level. And we just read that he's a God of exceedingly abundantly above. You know, when God grows you, he does not grow you like the way he grew me. Amen. He is a God. He does not grow you as you are expecting. He is a God of exceedingly abundantly above. Amen. That which you ask or imagine. Can somebody say amen? Amen. One thing you need to know, that the devil fights your growth. Tell your neighbor. Just know that. Turn to your neighbor. Tell them the devil fights your growth. The devil fights your growth. Oh, come on. Tell somebody. The devil fights your growth. Your growth is fought. Your progress is fought. Why? Because when you grow, he will not have an opportunity to torment you. Or somebody say amen. Amen. He will do all that you can that you do not grow. That is why the Bible is saying desire to grow. Be determined to grow. Just know that growth is your portion. And therefore begin to be intentional about growth. Even your prayer. You tell God, I want things to change. God, I cannot live in this apartment for this many years. Your word says I will grow. Or somebody say amen. I cannot remain in this job for years where I work 20 hours a day. I need to grow. I need to be the head and not the tail, because that is your word. I need to lead and not borrow, because that is your word. Or somebody say amen. Amen. God wants us to grow. So what are the few things I want to share with us as I wind up this morning? Four things that we do. I say growth is supernatural. But there are things that we are responsible for. Can I tell you one character of God? Is that he works with us. Amen. Amen. God works with us. No wonder you are not saved automatically. You are saved by decision. The gift of God is there, but he waits for you to receive it so that you can accept it. He will not force you, like the way our grandmother used to force us to drink porridge. Amen? He said he waits for you to accept it. So what are some of the things that we need to do to facilitate or to help or to speed up our growth? According to the passages that we have been reading, number one, obedience. Amen. Say obedience. 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 And I cannot insist enough, because we have been talking about it the last few weeks. Obedience is one of the things that speeds up your growth. Say obedience. Obedience. It is obedience to the word of God. Obedience to what God says. That's why Peter is saying, lay aside these things. Did you see that? He says, lay aside. Lay aside envy. Lay aside hypocrisy. Lay aside malice. In other words, lay aside sin so that you can grow. And that is why I was saying that sin hinders growth. Can you turn to your neighbor, tell them, sin will hinder your growth. You know, David prayed a prayer and he said, deliver me from sacred sin. Amen. Can I tell you, if you are stuck, search your life and you will find there is sin. And I say that in confidence. Somebody say amen. When you find a generation that is just stuck, when you find a family that does not go move on, when you find somebody who came here 20 years ago and they are going around, if you search quickly, there is sin in their life. Sin hinders growth. What is sin? Sin is doing contrary to what God has asked us to do. And that passage we have been looking at, Peter is saying, lay aside sin. You see, if we understand that sin will hinder our next level, no matter how much you stand and say, I speak a next level, I speak my next level, I speak my next level, and then you go out in sin, that will hinder your progress. Because you are not speaking your next level to any human being. You are speaking to God, and you cannot lie to God, and you cannot lie to the devil. What does sin do? The enemy takes a hold of your sin, and he uses it as a point of accusation, because he's an accuser of the brethren before God. You say, how can you bless her? Look at her life. So if you want to grow, hallelujah, if we want to grow in the Lord, if we want to grow in the things we are doing, if we want our families to grow, if we want our businesses to thrive, let's put away sin and begin to live in obedience. Obedience is your catalyst. Can you tell your neighbor? Obedience is the catalyst to your next level. Obedience is catalyst to the next level. Obedience. Think of it. Can you think of so many people in the world? Before God do something big in your life, he calls you to obedience. And we are not the first people. Think about Abraham. A time had come for God to bless Abraham. But what did he tell him? Leave? Huh? Leave this place. Go to the land that I'm going to show you. He doesn't even tell him which land. He said, go to the land that I'm going to show you. And in that land, I'll bless you. What does Abraham do? He obeys. David was obedient. Any person that God raised lived a life of obedience. If we are to grow and see a supernatural move of God, we must be willing to obey. I must be willing to obey, because disobedience hinders growth. Or somebody say amen. Amen. Disobedience will make strongholds, even in your family, to sit and torment a generation after another. You find that your grandma was sick with the same sickness. Your mother is sick with the same sickness, and now you have started to show symptoms. Yeah? What causes that? There lack a person who can turn around and cancel that generational curse through obedience. I love that God only looks for one person who will begin to obey, because obedience is so powerful, it can change an entire tribe. Somebody say amen. Amen. And disobedience can also cause a stronghold to stay. We have been looking about Saul. And the Bible says that rebellion, because the opposite of obedience is rebellion. When do you rebel? You rebel when we know the truth. We rebel, me included. We rebel when we know the truth, but we ignore it. Amen? Nobody will ever charge you with rebellion when you don't know. That is why I have a responsibility to teach the church the truth. But when you know the truth, and you decide to continue to walk in sin, the Bible calls you and I rebellious. Somebody say amen. Amen. And rebellion, the Bible says, is as a sin of witchcraft. In other words, the result of rebellion are equivalent to the sin of witchcraft. In other words, there are things that will be coming out of your life that will make somebody look at at you and think you are bewitched. Are you understanding that the fruit of rebellion is equivalent to a fruit of witchcraft? What does witchcraft do? Tell me. What does witchcraft do? Just shout it out. What does witchcraft do? Because witchcraft is real. What does witchcraft do? From where you come from? Do you know there's witchcraft even in America? Yeah? I hear them say white witchcraft and black witchcraft. What does witchcraft do? Yeah? It destroys. What does it destroy? Destiny. Amen. Witchcraft destroys destiny. A family that exercises witchcraft, look at their children. They go nowhere. If your grandmother practiced witchcraft, the children and the children of the children will experience unexplainable stagnation. Why? The purpose of witchcraft is to destroy destiny, is to make sure nobody meets their purpose. Somebody say amen. Amen. And the Bible says this, so where there is witchcraft, there is no, the sin of disobedience is equivalent to the sin of witchcraft. That means that it is the same. Anywhere people practice witchcraft, there is a lot of poverty. Somebody say amen. Amen. There is a lot of poverty in witchcraft. Why? People remain the same. They work hard, but there is nothing to show. Why? Because in witchcraft, there is no progress. Yeah. It's the same thing when we rebel against God. We go around the same mountain for so long, and there is no progress. But do you want to see progress and accelerate your growth? Remain in obedience. Somebody say amen. Amen. And that is obedience to what God says, obedience to hate sin. Proverbs 14:34. The Bible says, righteousness exalts a nation, but sin is a reproach to any people. Amen. Sin brings shame. Amen. Obedience brings exaltation. You know, I hate sin. The cost of sin is so much that if everybody got a revelation, you would live a life of obedience and continually repenting. That sinful habit, it is costly than how it is satisfying you. You hear what I say? That sinful habit, that thing you are doing, that you may think, oh, nobody will know. Say, oh, dress up and go to church. Nobody know where I've been. Let me tell you, the cost of that, it is so costly than us knowing. Actually, us knowing who are we. We are all working our salvation with fear and troubling. You and I will be stuck if we live in secret sin. David said, deliver me from secret sin. Somebody say amen. The other thing, and another scripture there you can look at is Psalm 119:11. Psalm 119:11. David said, I have hidden your word in me so that I may not sin against you. The more you grow, the more the word is hidden in you, so you are not able to sin before God. So number one is obedience. The other thing is desire. Ask your neighbor, do you have a desire? Ask your neighbor, do you have a desire? Do you have a desire? Do you have a desire to grow? What does the Bible say in Psalm 37:14? Psalm 37:4. The Bible says, delight yourself in the Lord, and I will. Huh? Delight yourself in the Lord, and I will fulfill the desire of your heart. God work with desire. Talk to your neighbor, tell them, God work with desire. God work with desire. What are you desiring? Amen. Do you know, It is a dangerous thing to lose desire. Yeah? You know, I've heard people say, me, I don't see anything big. You're in trouble. If you don't see a nice dress, you're in trouble. Yeah? If you don't see a nice car and desire, you're in trouble. If you don't see other people worshiping and tell God, take me to that level. If you don't hear the word and say, God, give me that understanding. God, help me to pray more. Is your, ask your neighbor, is your desire alive? Because God works with desire. Amen. And that is why sin chokes away our desire. Amen. But our desire is what God works with. What do you desire? What are you desiring in the work of God? Because when I talk to people, people know what God deposited in them when they believed. Ask your neighbor, what do you desire in the things of God? Have them give you an answer. Ask them to give you an answer. Ask them, what do you desire? Yeah? It is my prayer that we will not be in the house of God with no desire. Amen. What do you desire to see God do through you? Because you are strong. Because you are powerful. Because you carry destiny in you. You are to open your mouth and people are healed. Amen? Do you desire the next level? Or you are comfortable? You have a narrative like the world has narrative. Oh, you know, here in America, things are very hard. So it is sucks your desire. But when you have desire, you begin to say, I can do all things. Yes. Through Christ who strengthened me. Yes. That time you may have just $5 in your back. But you say, I can do all things. When you desire, do you desire even to move from the place you are living?
Yes.
Somebody say amen. Amen. Or you are just so comfortable. I pray that God restore your desire. Touch your neighbor, tell them, may God restore your desire. It does not matter how your miracle has done it. May God restore your desire. If you desire a family, may God restore that.
Amen.
So that you continue to stand on the promises of God until they come to pass.
Amen.
Do not let the devil steal your desire. So you begin to win. To waver. No, you say, God, I desire that. And as long as I delight myself in you, you shall bring it to pass. What do you desire? Oh, I used to mean nothing is big. Anyways, they have their houses on loans. Me, I don't desire that. And you live in the same studio for 10 years. That is not of God. Live in the same job where when the boss want to call you to go to work at the middle of the night, you go. That is not God. What do you desire? What do you desire? And as you desire the things of God, God begin to open your capacity to begin to desire great things in life. The Bible says, we shall be the head and not the tail. Oh, you know me, my Mazda 626, it is so old, but it works. There is no stronger car. And you justify your stagnancies. The stagnation, the devil is a liar. That nobody can talk to you because even in your perspective, you are stuck. But you know these cars, they are very old, but the way they were made. May God give you the desire. Because it is actually the desire that makes you desire to have expectations to get more. Or somebody say amen.
Amen.
If you don't have desire, you will justify stagnation. You will justify the reason why you are the way you are. But God wants you to change. Amen.
Amen.
Maybe you have lost your desire to love because somebody hurt you. I awaken your desire. It is of God that you be loved. Somebody say amen. It is of God that you love somebody. It is of God I love and I be loved. And the devil can do nothing about it. No matter how much it delays, don't let the devil kill your desire. Whatever you desire, don't worry if it has delayed. God. have desire and not me actually. That couple there, Liz. Liz had a desire for her husband to leave.
Yes.
Amen. And she's like, God, I desire that you make Frederick live again.
Yes.
For the sake of her his children,
yes,
and for the sake of our family.
Yes.
Imagine if such a storm come in your life,
yes,
and you do not have a desire. You agree to what these people are telling you,
yes,
and they are telling you it, they cannot do anything. And your lack of desire,
yeah,
it will give room to the enemy.
Yes.
But when you desire,
yes,
you begin to say, he shall leave.
Yes.
Or he will arise.
Yes.
You just need to give us more time. He will wake up.
Yes.
You say, now we wait on God, who is a miracle working God.
Yes.
You push your desire until you see every promise of God fulfilled in your life. Tell God, God, awaken my desire. Whatever area of your life that the enemy has stolen desire, may it be restored on the basis that you obeyed God and came to the house of God this morning. May you grow to see the deliverance of God. Somebody say amen. Oh my goodness, I'm out of time. The other thing, and this is where I want, but before that, let me say, how do you show that you have desire? Number one, be teachable. Tell your neighbor, you don't know everything. You don't know everything.
Be teachable.
A desire makes you to be teachable. A desire makes you to want to sit down and listen and learn how things are done.
Yeah.
A desire makes you want to be in the house of God so that you can listen to me, and sometimes for an hour and a half, so that this word can work for you.
Yeah.
Tell your neighbor, to have desire and grow must be teachable. It is such a loss in life to have a spirit or an attitude that does not want to be taught. Say, be teachable. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
The other characteristic of desire is be available. Be available. To have a desire is to be available to go to the next level. And because that cannot happen in isolation, you have to be somewhere that you are being pushed to grow. So be available. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
The other thing is be faithful. Okay, you desire to grow. You desire. You have this desire. Be faithful in what God has given you. I don't think that this is a new message to us this morning. Be faithful. You know, it is in the kingdom protocol that if you're faithful with what is little, your growth is automatic. God will entrust you with more. But if you are not faithful, if you're sure with what is little, you remain in the same level. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
So desire means you are teachable, you are available, and you are faithful. That's the kingdom protocol. Finally, and this is where I end. Be ready. Be willing to handle the discomfort of growth. Amen. So be obedient, have desire, and number four, be willing to handle the discomfort of growth. Touch your neighbor, be willing.
Be
courageous to handle the discomfort of growth. Somebody say amen. When we read scripture, and that's what I've been saying, that any time that God grew somebody, whether it's Abraham, whether it's Esther, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, Daniel, think of anybody that God used. They had, even David, they went through some type of discomfort. Can I tell you something? Comfort is the greatest enemy to growth. Woo! Somebody say amen.
Amen.
Comfort. What do you call comfort in your language? Comfort is the greatest enemy to grow. People remain in the same level because we are uncomfortable with the discomfort of the growth zone. Somebody say amen. I love one of the quotes that says, there is no comfort in growth zone. Yeah? There is no comfort in, turn to your neighbor, tell them there is no comfort in the growth zone. Yet, are you comfortable? Ask your neighbor, are you comfortable? Maybe you came here and sat on that nice chair. Are you comfortable? Somebody say amen. There is no comfort. Anytime you feel comfortable that nothing else bother you, there is no growth. Somebody say amen. And there is no growth in the comfort zone. Amen? So there is no comfort in the growth zone. And there is no growth in the comfort zone. If you're too comfortable, that, like the way I'm saying, me, I'm just good. You are just comfortable coming to church and sitting there. Never talking to anybody, never carrying anybody burden. Never even worrying how these lights are turned off. You know that those things are past. Me, I just come. Go in and out, and then go home. Comfort zone is the danger, is the greatest danger to your growth. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
And I want to give you an assignment. God in Abraham, God in Joseph, God in Esther, Jesus himself. What does the Bible say? Jesus was willing to leave his home in glory. Hallelujah. Jesus was willing to leave his home in glory. He did not consider it worthy to be like God. He came, he humbled himself into a nature of man. What happened? As a result, God gave him a name that is above any other name, that every knee bow and every tongue confess that Jesus is Lord. That did not come in the comfort. He left his home in glory.
Yes.
Or somebody say amen. Amen. If Jesus would leave his comfort, how about you? What is the area of your life that you need to leave comfort? Are you prayerless because you don't want to be uncomfortable waking up in the morning? It's too much. Somebody say amen. It's so much. Faith grows in uncomfortable places. God, let me tell you, God will push you to do things that are so uncomfortable, that will actually make you very unpopular. I've been teaching about David and I'm winding up. Do you know when David was anointed, discomfort began? Amen? Discomfort began. He left the wilderness, and I believe wilderness was peaceful. He went to the palace. When he went to the palace, battle began. Saul began to chase after him. Year after year, and the Bible says for 14 years, David was running for his life. Maybe you or I would have given up. But David was willing to see. How long can you tolerate to live in caves? Ask your neighbor, how long can you live in a cave? Somebody say amen. How long? But if God has anointed you, and each one of us has a measure of faith, do you know that?
Yes.
The day you believed, there is purpose in you. There's something that God wants to do in your life. And I tell you, when you allow God to begin to work in your life, it's bigger than you. Remember, I've been saying that there are people waiting for you to grow up.
Yes.
Somebody say amen. There are breakthroughs that are yours. If only you would leave your comfort zone. So as we wind this series, I'm going to ask you, what comfort has hindered your growth? What comfort has hindered your growth? What is it that is keeping you in the level that you are? Is it the comfort of mind? Is it the comfort of body? You're just lazy. Somebody say amen. Is it the comfort of letting the familiar go? You just like the way your mother made ugali back in the village. You are that comfortable. As long as we remain in the comfort zone, you know, as we sit here, we have been through, as a church, through a lot of discomfort. If you're in the leadership, we've been through a lot of discomfort as we have constructed, we are constructing. Even now, who wanna be in a hall that is covered with a plastic paper? Who wants to be in a hall? Maybe you have not noticed because you are comfortable. Amen. Did you notice that our door is covered with a plastic paper? Did you notice there that we no longer have a booth, a sound booth? Do you see Abel sitting out there?
Yeah.
Or have you noticed? Oh, you're comfortable. Have you noticed we don't have a main door? You know, when that door disappeared, I don't remember who came here. They almost wanted to fight me. Pastor, where is our door? If you're visiting, we are not always without a door there. They usually are door. Yeah? But we have been, what, almost a month or two without a door. All these discomforts. There is a lot of dust. If you walk around, Nancy's staff are full of dust. You will need to get women here for a day and dust all those things. There's dust anywhere, everywhere. Why? We are in a growth zone.
Yes.
Somebody say amen.
Amen.
The reason why we can tolerate discomfort is because right now we are in a growth zone. I thought you would say amen.
Amen.
Somebody say amen. Amen. We can tolerate that. I was telling somebody, honestly, I have to get all new winter shoes, boots. Because any time I come here and I go to the other side, my boots are all ashy. My clothes are ashy. Because I've been walking around in the construction site. But I am not worried about that. Because I know I am in a growth zone. Things will change very soon. Somebody say amen. What comfort have you tolerated that has hindered your growth? God wants you to grow. Can you stand up on your feet this morning and begin to tell God to help you? Begin to possess your next level. Maybe you need to deal with your obedience. Maybe you need to deal with desire. Maybe you need to deal with... with